Hello, geospatial enthusiasts. What is the role of geospatial data in achieving sustainable development goals? Why are US taxpayers paying $490 million to Russia? Why is billionaire Tom Siebel pushing for smart energy? And which retailer has turned to location-based marketing of late? Stay tuned to find out all this and more on today's GeoBytes. I'm your host, Bhanu. A new bureau for the United Nations Committee of Experts on Global Geospatial Information Management, UNGGIM, was announced in New York yesterday. At the inaugural of the 5th UNGGIM meeting, Li Pengde of the National Administration of Surveying, Mapping and Geoinformation, China, Rolando Ocampo of National Institute of Statistics and Geography of Mexico, and Timothy Trainer of the United States Census Bureau were elected as the new co-chairs of the Global Committee. The outgoing co-chair, Dr. Vanessa Lawrence, was felicitated for her contribution in the last 4 years. This year's meeting is witness to a record attendance of about 300 delegates from 80 countries. They're currently deliberating on the role and importance of geospatial data in achieving the Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs. Dr. Lawrence pointed out that because of UNGGIM's efforts, geospatial information has found a place in the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. This agenda will be adopted by heads of states in the UN in September. Another key achievement of UNGGIM is the resolution of Global Geodetic Reference Framework in February this year. UNGGIM recognizes the growing demand for precise positioning services, the economic importance of a global geodetic reference frame, and the need to improve global cooperation within geodesy. Which is why, on Wednesday, member states expressed the need for accurate, timely and reliable data access for achieving SDGs. Members also felt that apart from focusing on data generation, UNGGIM should also concentrate on the processes involved in that. NASA has signed a $490 million contract with Russia to get additional seats on Soyuz spacecraft for taking its astronauts to and from the International Space Station. In a rather stern letter to the Congress, NASA blamed lack of funds for the commercial crew program for America's continued reliance on Russia. NASA Administrator Charles Bolden wrote, and I quote, "I'm asking that we put past disagreements behind us and focus our collective efforts on support for American industry, the Boeing Corporation and SpaceX, to complete construction and certification of their crew vehicles so that we can begin launching our crews from the space coast of Florida in 2017, I unquote. NASA has also announced that Kirk Sherman will succeed Mike Sufferendi as the new ISS program manager. In a major push to the nation's energy infrastructure, tech billionaire Tom Siebel has announced the foundation of Siebel Energy Institute. The institute will dish out $10 million in grants over the next 5 years to fund research in smart energy. The first batch of grant recipients was announced earlier this week. The proposals include ideas like how to make smartphones monitor power grids and how drones can be used to predict maintenance needs. Siebel feels that even though the energy grid is getting equipped with more and more sensors, we are not able to take advantage of all the data that is generated. The billionaire wants to address that absence of a software layer.
Okay, a cyber-physical system are these systems where we have, you know, large sensor networks, okay, a multiplicity of data sources, people, and analytics to do interesting things. And these cyber-physical systems, this is what you know of as kind of the Internet of Things. So we can talk about this as the Internet of Energy. And we basically spent the last 7 years and a couple hundred million dollars building a technology foundation that allows people, that allows a grid operator, say a GDF Suez and an Enel and Exelon, to aggregate the union of the data from all these operational systems in a unified federated cloud image. We're not replacing any of these systems, we're just aggregating the data and then keeping it current in real time.
Target has turned to location-based marketing to boost customers' experience. On Wednesday, the retailer rolled out beacon technology in 50 locations across the United States. In these stores, the Target app will give out timely deals and recommendations on nearby products to the shoppers. Users need to download the latest version of the Target iPhone app, switch on their phone's Bluetooth, and share the location with the retailer while they are inside the store. And don't worry, the company will not bombard you with pop-ups. You will not receive more than 2 notifications per shopping trip. The test stores are located in Chicago, Denver, Minneapolis, New York City, Pittsburgh, Portland, San Francisco, and Seattle. Go check them out. And for those of you Android lovers, the company is working on building an app for you too. Boundary-based spatial data provider Maponix has introduced a major update to its context crime scores product. The improved offering uses data from 2 sources, the FBI and the police department. This data has been used to create national and local crime scores. This knowledge about geographic areas will not only help real estate developers and business owners, it will also assist home buyers and sellers to make better informed decisions. The data is based on 1 year's worth of data, which means that it is not skewed by just 1 or 2 incidents. Take San Francisco, for example. While the metropolitan area has an overall mid-level national crime rate, the neighborhood of Nob Hill enjoys a low rate of crime. Moving on, did you know that the majority of people live in very hot climates? Or that more than 40% of the Earth's soil is poor for most crops? Revelations like this come from a new app called Field Notes Earth, an Esri app for Android and iOS devices. The app allows users to discover interesting facts about people, climate, and geography for any location on the planet. After choosing the area you're interested in, you can find answers to 18 pertinent questions. For example, how crowded is this location? How close am I to an earthquake zone? How hot would my area be in 2050? The app uses maps from Esri's Living Atlas of the World. It includes the World Ecological Land Units map, the New World Seafloor Geomorphology map, and the World Population Estimate map. Verisk Insurance Solutions has announced that it is expanding its aerial imagery database across the United States. The updated collection of imagery and data will power the database for the company's Property Insight solution and ExactWare business. Property Insight can be used for remote exterior building inspections and risk assessment. ExactWare, meanwhile, processes the high-quality imagery and data to provide information about the exterior of a structure, 3D property models, landscaping plan, etc. ExactWare President and CEO Jim Loveland insists that the demand for high-quality imagery and for data captured specifically for property workflows is continuously growing in the country. We will now slip into a short break, but when we return, we will take a look at what's happening in the rest of the world.
Geospatial industry is evolving with time, adding newer dimensions, converging with other technologies, and expanding across verticals. Feel the pulse of its growth story. Catch the technology innovators system integrators, business drivers, and policymakers share their knowledge, experiences, and ideas at GeoBiz Leaders Summit. Join the knowledge pool.
Welcome back. Canadian government will now get free access to TerraSRX and TandemX satellite imagery for pre-operational use. Airbus Defence and Space has signed an agreement with the Canada Centre for Mapping and Earth Observation to this effect. The partnership aims to support Canadian agencies' missions of maritime surveillance, disaster management, and environmental monitoring. What's more, free access to this satellite imagery will also support study purposes and capacity building through professional training and education. The TerraSRX and TandemX radar satellite missions are located above the Arctic Circle, which allows them to access most of the orbits in a timely manner. The European Space Agency ESA has announced it has successfully conducted 100 high-speed laser links between its Sentinel-1A and AlphaSat satellites. While the Earth observation satellite Sentinel-1A orbits from a pole to pole about 700 kilometers up, geostationary satellite AlphaSat hovers around 36,000 kilometers above the Earth. Creating a link between the two means more information can be streamed to Earth and almost continuously. This is quite a significant development, as having timely access to Sentinel-1 imagery, for example, is essential for maritime safety and disaster management. Communication testing began last November. ESA is happy to report that the 100th link, which was established within 50 seconds on July 14, maintains stable bit error-free communications for 10 minutes. Thousands of historical aerial photographs of the United Kingdom have been made available online by GIS and environmental data provider Blue Sky. These photos date back more than 70 years. The collection, which is called Old Aerial Photos, includes some of the earliest commercial aerial survey images, military photographs, and national archives. They offer a record of most major UK cities and towns, transport and utility infrastructure, and commercial property developments. These photos should prove to be a valuable resource for those interested in local studies, genealogy, boundary disputes, environmental land use research, or town planning. China's Ministry of Environmental Protection has announced that by 2020, the country will build a comprehensive network of satellites, drones, and remote sensors to detect pollution. The government has stepped up research on two environmental monitoring satellites. Another two satellites are being developed to provide imagery with higher resolution than what is currently available. Drones have already proved effective in locating polluted areas in northern China by identifying scattered summer straw burnings. The Environment Minister has also assured that the ministry will strengthen the supervision of data collected through multiple channels to keep policies and measures effective and scientific. We have another report coming in from China. Commercial Earth Observation Satellite Provider 21st Century Aerospace Technology, or 21AT, says that it is looking forward to the commencement of data services from the DMC-3 triple-sat constellation. The high-resolution imagery collected from the satellites will be used for urban planning and management in China. The UK-built satellites were successfully placed in a low-Earth orbit by an Indian launch vehicle last month. In the next 2 months, the three DMC units will be phased 120 degrees apart around the same orbit using their onboard propulsion systems. This would allow the satellites to target any location on the Earth once every day. That's all we have for you in GeoBytes today. Find us on www.geobiz.com. And follow GeoBuiz on Twitter. Stay tuned for a special program on former President of India and Space and Nuclear Scientist, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam.
Can you tell us a little bit about GEO and what it is that you do in the organization?
We have a lot of obviously formidable competitors in the mapping space.
But saying human GEO, I was like perplexed. Why the name human to the geospatial angle?
If we think about land, I mean, land is a key core to prosperity.
Thank you, Hugo, for speaking with GeoBuiz and Geospatial World.
July 27th, India lost its most popular president. The president who was a space scientist, a writer, a poet, and a teacher. Widely known as India's missile man, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam died the way he lived his life, at work. An enthusiast for sharing ideas with the youth, he was addressing students at IIM Shillong when he collapsed and died shortly afterwards. An illustrious scientist, Dr. Kalam rose to become India's first citizen in the most unexpected manner. The move came after he was nominated as an all-party consensus candidate in 2002 for the post of the president.
I, Bhanu, Pathir, Jainalabuddin, Abdul Kalam,
do swear in the name of God.
Do swear in the name of God.
That I will faithfully execute the office of the President of India.
That I will faithfully execute the office of the President of India.
It's a fascinating story how a poor village boy rose to spearhead topmost science projects in the country. Born and raised in the South Indian city of Rameswaram, a young Kalam supplemented his poor family's income by delivering newspapers. He never let those difficulties daunt him and had his focus on his goals. He graduated in physics from St. Joseph's College in Trichy and initially sought a career in the Indian Air Force. But fate had other plans for him. The selection board didn't see much of an airman in the young aspirant and turned him down. Disappointed but determined, Kalam decided to study aeronautical engineering at the Madras Institute of Technology, a move that would one day catapult him to a key leadership role in India's then struggling space program. That was a time when India's space program did not have many buyers. Critics questioned the rationale of spending so much money on the space initiatives when millions in the country were going hungry and homeless. India launching its own satellites seemed just an idea till Kalam's team launched Rohini in 1980, thus making India a member of the exclusive space corps.
SLV-3, India's first satellite launch vehicle, was the major stepping stone in his career as well as for the nation. I was working with him as a project engineer for the SLV-3. Later, the PSLV, GSLV and other rocket system evolved based on the technologies we developed in the SLV-3 timeframe. No wonder the nation has entrusted the responsibility of developing the missile system for the country and also the weapon system, which is very much needed for the country. And he has very successfully integrated the technologies and people to achieve great goals for the nation, which is unimaginable at the time frame in which he has conceived. He was a great visionary, at the same time a great motivator, and he brought out the best in the people.
Impressed with his work, then Prime Minister Indira Gandhi put him in charge of India's secret missile program. Kalam joined the Defence Research and Development Organisation, where his plans resulted in a number of successful missile launches, earning him the nickname Missile Man. Kalam was the man behind Agni and Prithvi missiles.
Kalam then left for, I think, the RDO. And to me, as a young engineer at that time, it appeared strange that such an eminent person should leave this organization when he is at the peak of his career. But then followed the Integrated Guided Missile Development Program and the successes which came one after the other. Kalam became a household word and eminent scientist in his own right.
Kalam also played a pivotal role in making India a nuclear power. On a grey morning in 1974, the world came to know of India's peaceful nuclear explosion in the Rajasthan desert. But it was only in 1998 that Kalam emerged as a national hero after the second successful tests in Pokhran. An unlikely compromise candidate for the post of president, he soon became the most popular occupant of that exalted office, disregarding its customary ceremonial role to reach out to ordinary people. He was popular among the youth and urged them to dream big and become achievers in life. He would combine PowerPoint presentations of his vision for India with poems for children and lecture on everything from solar energy to broadband connectivity for villages. Abdul Kalam ignited many minds.
I am indeed delighted to be with the honorable members of the European Parliament on the occasion of the Golden Jubilee Year of the European Union. I am reminded of the dream of an Indian poet, Kaniyan Pungundranar, who articulated in 3,000 years back in Tamil classic Purananur. He says, Yadum Ure Yavarum Keli, which means, I am a world citizen, every citizen is my own kith and kin, he said 3,000 years back. As we say in India, where there is righteousness in the heart, where there is righteousness in the heart, there is beauty in the character. When there is beauty in the character, there is harmony in the home. When there is harmony in the home, there is harmony, there is an order in the nation. When there is order in the nation, there is peace in the world.
India is going to miss him. India's youth are going to miss him. The children are going to miss him. As somebody said, you know, after Pandit Nehru, he was the one Indian person who could connect with children. And I grew up in Chacha Nehru's time. But I wish I was a kid again. Seeing Kalam, I wish I was a kid again and interact with him in that lively and carefree manner.
His enthusiasm and passion for hard work proved infectious for many scientists and engineers at ISRO. He held that India's primary mission was three-pronged: freedom, development, and self-reliance. He led ISRO in chanting this mantra, inspiring a whole new generation of scientists to achieve technological self-reliance in a world of jealous competitors.
We remember him as a person who is extremely knowledgeable and then a person of great qualities, and he was very amicable, and he used to interact with all the people with great simplicity, and it's a great loss to the country.
One of the most distinguished scientists of India, Kalam received honorary doctorates from 30 universities and institutions. He was also the recipient of India's highest civilian award in 1997. Dr. Kalam was a great champion of geospatial technology. He believed with rapid technological developments in the last 55 years, geospatial technology will become a game changer, particularly in the development of rural and remote places of the world. In his keynote address at the Geospatial World Forum 2012 in Amsterdam, he deliberated upon the applications of geospatial technology for sustainable development of 3 billion people living in rural areas of the world. It is but natural that the international geospatial community has expressed intense grief and shock over Dr. Kalam's sudden demise.
While expressing his condolences, Jack Dangermond, the president and founder of ESRI, said, "The president was both a thoughtful scientist and a visionary as it relates to geospatial data and technology. He helped pioneer everything from remote sensing to open data and geodata policies for India. Mostly, I appreciated his open personality and practical approach to discussing the future of GIS in India."
Preetha Bulsani, Gibraltar's president for the American market, had this to say about him. "In 2012, I had the distinct honor and privilege of meeting Dr. Abdul Kalam at a global geospatial conference in Amsterdam. I was witness to his presence there and even had the additional great honor of sharing a panel with this great man. It quickly became obvious to me that although his background was not geospatial technologies, his scientific brain had absorbed this subject matter rapidly. He gave a keynote presentation that enthralled the audience at the conference, one filled with global experts and specialists in all matters geospatial."
David Schell, Chairman Emeritus of the OGC Board, said, "Several years ago, I was honored to receive an award from the hands of Dr. Kalam. After the award ceremony, Dr. Kalam invited me to talk over tea about the cultural implications of interoperability, expressing in particular his interest in social change through education. I was deeply affected by his generosity of spirit and the quiet assurance of his conviction. These qualities inspired me, as I understand he had inspired the many students and scientists."
Dr. Kalam was a true Renaissance man. He was passionate about science and yet could quote from the scriptures. As a Muslim steeped in Hindu culture, he was an oddity, a scientist who could recite classical Tamil poetry, play the veena, and enjoyed Carnatic music. Abdul Kalam was an embodiment of India's diversity.
I had the privilege for quite some time having had a close interaction with late Dr. Abdul Kalam. He is a trained Veena artist. I had the privilege of listening to his various songs, particularly tunes of late MS, Subbalakshmi on Veena, which not only used to be played in Rashtrapati Bhavan, but also in some of the government offices. Knowledge and interest in Thirukkural. Thirukkural is 1,330 couplets by the Tamil saint Thiruvalluvar, enunciating various way of life, the rules and regulations.
With his long silver hair framing his face and his thick Tamilian accent, he was an unlikely pop culture idol, but that was what he had become. During his term as the president, Kalam opened the gates of the presidential house to ordinary Indians. He would often host school children, farmers, and scientists.
It's a strange coincidence that his demise happened while he was interacting with the children. That was his passion. After stepping down from his office, he has spent all the time to enthuse the young generation to take up the challenges of nation building and also to take on the challenges in the field of science and technology. And he believed it is only through the science and technology a country can achieve progress.
One of the most enduring lessons in Dr. Kalam's life was the value of persistence, which he learned at a very young age. Once, his father, a boatman, was ferrying passengers when a cyclone hit the coast. The boat was destroyed, but his father soon built another and resumed work. A year later, another cyclone struck, sweeping away all the boats. Unswayed, his father went about building another one. Later, when a satellite booster launch had to be postponed repeatedly because of bad weather, Kalam would recall his father's words, "The only way to survive is to face your troubles and rebuild your life."
Kalam is no more, but his ideas, his books in particular, are there for all of us to read and remember and follow. And one of the things which struck me most is that statement which he made, "When I die, do not observe a holiday for me. Work another extra day." That, in my opinion, was the essence of Kalam.
Not many know that Dr. Kalam was a poet too. His favorite poem was The Vision, which he also recited in Parliament.
"I climbed and climbed. Where is the peak, my lord? I climbed and climbed. Where is the peak, my lord? I plowed and plowed. Where is the knowledge treasure, my lord? I plowed and plowed. Where is the knowledge treasure, my lord? I sailed and sailed. Where is the island of peace, my lord? I sailed and sailed. Where is the island of peace, my lord? Almighty, bless my nation with vision and sweat resulting into happiness."
Hello, welcome to the second episode of panel discussions on land matters. We all know about 75% of the world population do not yet have access to a formal land administration system, Many of these people are poor and vulnerable sections of the society who do not have a kind of a they cannot safeguard their right over the piece of the land they own. The solutions, the land administration solutions at present are more technology intensive, resource intensive, and also time consuming, and they take almost decades to be able to give any value to these sections of the society. So what is the alternative? What is the alternative geospatial technology can provide? It is a fit for purpose land administration system that is more custom designed. It is also more relevant and based on the need of the particular country and the existing land administration system at that point in time in the country. To discuss what exactly is fit for purpose land administration and how development needs can be achieved with fit for purpose land administration, we have a panel of experts today talking to me on this topic, sustainability and scalability of fit for purpose land administration system. I welcome Christian Lehmann, Senior Geodetic Advisor at Cadastre International, who is joining us live on Skype. In studio with me is... Hello, Crit. Welcome to Land Matters panel discussion.
Good to see you.
Thank you. And in the studio, we have Brent Jones, Global Manager, Cadastre Land Records, ESRI, on my left. Welcome, Brent. Thank you for joining us on this panel.
Thanks, Bhanu.
Okay, and we also have in the studios today Dr. Jolene Sanjak, Executive Director, Land Alliance Incorporation. Jolene, thank you so much for joining us on this panel. Jolene has been associated with the Land Alliance, which is a non-profit which is working on resolving land issues to address the development challenges. Jolene, welcome to the panel.
Thank you.
First and foremost, Crit, you have co-authored a joint publication with FIG and the World Bank on this specific topic called Fit for Purpose Land Administration. So my first question goes to you. How do you see, what is your perspective of Fit for Purpose Land Administration?
Well, thank you. I think the most important issue is that, let's say, for 70% of the people, as you said in your introduction, land administration is not available. Land data are not accessible. So what we see is that because of this lack of coverage, that there are, let's say, many land disputes. We see land grabbing in many countries all over the world. We see that let's say traditional groups of people, that their land rights are not very well protected. And we also see all kind of problems in the, let's say, the development, the economic and also the social developments, because you know, in my lifetime, I'm 59 years old, the world population doubled. So all those people need food, and they need a place to live and work. And so we see this urbanization. And this is, let's say, those developments are in most countries completely uncontrolled. So there is no spatial planning. And for all those purposes, land use planning, tenure security, economic development, you need a proper land administration, which is not available in most countries, or at least not complete. So we need coverage, we need land administration and access to land data for all people. We need tenure security, we need information for the government to govern. So all those needs require good land data. That is about spatial units, it's about land right holders, and about the relationships between people and land. And that is not only about formal relationships between people and land, it is also about informal and customary relations. And of course, the national resources, the state lands, have to be protected for sustainable development in the near future.
What kind of a framework do you suggest to make a land administration more fit for purpose?
I'm sorry, I missed your question.
What kind of a framework do you suggest for fit for purpose land administration? What are the basic guidelines do you think a land administration should address when it has to be a really a fit for purpose one?
Okay, first of all, there should be, let's say, coverage, inclusion of all spatial units in a spatial framework, protection of all land rights for all people. There is a very important issue that is the gender issue. So also the rights of women have to be protected, because in many countries that is not very well organized. It could be much better organized. So coverage and land administration for all, land data accessible for all, is the main goal to be achieved.
Okay. Thank you so much, Krit, for your opening remarks. Brent, I would like to turn this question to you. You have been working across several geographies in the world on cadastral and land administration systems. What are the elements should be in a fit-for-purpose land administration?
Well, Krit mentioned that there's rights, there's spatial units, and there's people or parties.
Yes.
So how do we connect those dots with technology properly that fits the need, whether it's a social tenure or it's a legal tenure. So we connect those dots with different types of tools. Mm-hmm. When land administration, land registration, cadastral systems first started, it was all paper-based, and we cataloged the paper, then we computerized the paper, and then we made maps, and then we computerized the maps. We connected all those pieces together. Today we have a whole different set of tools that we can choose what's fit for purpose. We can use different types of mapping devices, whether we want to use Android phones or drones. We have different types of enumeration techniques, whether we can use a formal census system or we need a more informal enumeration system. And then we have different ways to collect and catalog that data, whether we want to do it on paper again or whether we want to do it in the cloud. So fit for purpose, from my point of view, is choosing from those three areas, the people, the spatial units, or the geometry or location, as we would say, and the rights and the tenure. What do we select for appropriate technologies and connect those together for the to fit the purpose, to fit the specification, to fit the problem we're trying to solve?
Okay, I think in the entire value chain of what you spoke about, the people, connecting the people, the spatial databases, and also ensuring the land rights of the people, technology plays a very, very important and key role. Julian, if I may ask, what do you think the role of technology in developing a fit-for-purpose land administration?
Okay, I think that's a very important question to ask, because I think that some people may interpret fit for purpose to imply that we shouldn't be advantaging from the most modern and recent technologies. And in some contexts, in certain ways, it does. So we may not need the most accurate tool for mapping a parcel. We can, in some cases, use general boundaries, in some cases, maybe not. And I think that really what fit for purpose implies to me is bringing together an understanding of the purpose or purposes, the technology options, the policy constraints or enablers, and the human perspective into a system that will work in the context in time and that will be adaptable over time as those purposes change and development happens. So just a small example, I think in Rwanda, I believe that the idea was to move to general boundaries and away from geospatially referenced perhaps more expensive technologies. We have a pilot program going in Peru, which is looking pretty successful, where we're using unmanned aerial vehicles to really open up more transparency, make a quicker and lower cost process for keeping the cadastral and registry up to date in a context where the Inter-American Development Bank had done a titling program over a period of years, which is now at a sustainability risk. So this is the kind of technology is able to both bring a people-centered approach, create trust, in fact, between the government, local government and the people, and open up a space for sustainability of the technologies and the information systems.
Okay. Okay. Krit, I would like to turn this question to you as well, because you have been associated with Cadastre and Cadastre International for quite a while and been associated with several projects. What is your understanding and your impressions and how simplified technology can be used for fit-for-purpose land administration systems?
You know, today fit-for-purpose land administration is possible because the technology is available. I mean, we have many sensors providing satellite imagery worldwide almost every day. We have GPS, and we have today those, let's say, handheld devices which provide sub-meter accuracy. We can manage the data in the cloud because the development of information systems is not an easy task. But today, services are available to manage the data in the cloud. So I think the role of technology is crucial. But of course, it is not the only issue, because it is also about recognition of land rights. So that, let's say, states and governments recognize all those customary tenures and also, let's say, the informal types of tenure. So that makes it possible to categorize them and to classify them and to include them as such in the system. And of course, it is also very important that we have the capacity available. Brent was talking about enumeration. If you, let's say, look to such an activity worldwide, you need, of course, hundreds and of thousands of people. So if we use technology, the interfaces should be simple and easy to understand, even for illiterate people in many cases.
I think that's a very important point. The interfaces should be very simple. Brent, we were having a discussion on a pilot demo kind of a solution which Esri has developed for this purpose. Would you like to share more detail on that?
Sure,
open source one?
Sure, we got together with Cadastre and Cadastre International, and we took the land administration domain model and implemented that into an ArcGIS Online environment, where it's a hosted system where all the data resides in the cloud and it's accessed through mobile devices. We were able to do that for a couple of reasons. One, there's technology standards of how to communicate back and forth. There's technology standards of how to use imagery. There's technology standards of just buying an Android off the shelf and using it. Mm-hmm. But equally as important, there are domain standards of how what information we collect and how we collect it. So we used the land administration domain model to do this. The reason that's important is because using these standards eliminated any custom development work. There was no custom development work. There was some configuration to this using these standards. That allows a couple of things. It allows you to configure a system to work very quickly for your use, but it also enables it to be scalable for other purposes. As Jolene mentioned, that you build a fit-for-purpose system and it fits that purpose. And as it's being used, you're going to find weak spots, and you're going to have new uses for that information. And adhering to standards allows you to scale, not necessarily just size-wise, but functionality-wise.
Exactly. Okay, that's, I think, quite an important aspect in developing a fit-for-purpose land administration. It might not necessarily be serving only one purpose, because any land administration has to be very flexible in supporting the environment, supporting the land use, supporting the planning purposes, and an umpteen variety of things. Jolene, would you like to share more views on how important it is to have a flexible land administration, which is also fit for purpose?
Yeah, so I think we're all swirling around an important point here, which, you know, if I'm thinking about the post 2015 sustainable development goals.
Yes.
And if you look at that agenda, basically it's saying, you know, we need inclusion.
Mm-hmm.
We need to bring those 70% into the formal system, including into the formal land administration system, so that they can be part of the economic trajectory. We also need to make sure we have a sustainable environment. We need investment. We need job creating investment, and we need public services that support people in their lives and their livelihoods. Really, land administrations underpin all of those, and so the multiple purposes are there. I think we need to really, when we're defining, the advantage of fit for purpose is it gives you the flexibility to look in a context and say, what's the priority among those purposes or priorities, and you know, how do we build from where we are now to there in a way that serves those multiple objectives, allowing people to afford to be in the system, that is in turn important to the sustainability of the system itself, allowing that data then to be used effectively for planning. But you know, also it's, you know, we're also considering sometimes that maybe there's an entry point that doesn't start with formalizing the 70%. Maybe it starts, like in Cross River State, with getting a better ability to collect taxes that are due so that the government can then provide better services, coupled with a national effort to include people. So I think flexibility means embracing different entry points,
mm-hmm.
and different kinds of technologies suitable to context, as we've all said. And just to kind of reiterate, it's economic purposes, but also social and human rights kind of perspectives, and we need to be able to bring those together. Fit for purpose ideally would allow us to be more sensible in bringing those together into a good dynamic.
Okay, I think I'll take this point of embracing various entry points. So that is the definition that needs to be the underpinning effort for a land fit for purpose land administration. Krit, what are your ideas in making this land administration more flexible?
Well, the flexibility is in many areas. First of all, when it is about the spatial framework. Spatial units, if you collect them, you can let's say perform very accurate land surveys, land measurements, which provides you with very accurate coordinates. But it is also possible, let's say, to implement spatial units in alternative ways. It is possible to, let's say, to collect one point for each individual spatial unit. That is very much applicable in slum areas, for example. It is possible to use less accurate approaches. So you can draw the boundaries on top of an image, and vectorize those drawn boundaries later in a geographic information system. For the urban centers, you can even go to three-dimensional volumes, but that is of course only needed if the value of the land is very high. So for the remote urban areas, you can work with submeter accuracy. You can use images. So that is flexibility and spatial unit. And there is, of course, also, it is very important that there is flexibility in the land rights, which can be represented in the system. As I said, it is not only about formal land rights, which are defined in civil code and so on. It is also about informal and this wide continuum of customary land rights. And also at the side of the right holders, there is a range of options. So when it is about social tenures, when it is about informal tenure, it should be possible to represent it, and that is only possible if the those land rights are recognized.
I think that's a very valid point. Time and again, we're coming to that. Technology is so simplified these days. It is very easy to make a fit for purpose land administration. But there is another equally important aspect of tenure and land rights. Jolene, would you like to throw some light on how we can streamline land rights aspects or work around those issues to get the people who are out of the formal land rights system into a fit-for-purpose land administration system?
Okay, yeah, just really quickly, because I'm cognizant of time, I think there's many aspects to that. So first, as you said, technology enables that. We have data models now, the social tenure domain model, mm-hmm. that was developed precisely to not have a one-to-one mapping, there's a parcel and there's an owner, but to recognize that a piece of land may have multiple different layers of rights. So we have a database model that can enable that. We have different applications that can be used in the field to make, and I gave one example with UAVs, there's lots of examples of mobile phone technology that can enable people to access. But it also, frankly, requires procedural change. I think business processes need to be adjusted and simplified themselves, because you can put technology on top of a business process and still end up with a long, complicated, expensive, unaffordable approach to titling and recognizing rights and registering them. Crit also gave examples of using a single point rather than all the boundaries. There's some interesting models where the perimeter of a community's land rights, I've heard examples in urban areas in Namibia, for example, and there's examples in rural areas in Liberia, Mozambique, where the perimeter is documented and the internal community affairs are managed amongst themselves. So you can save time and money giving a security of tenure without going parcel by parcel internally, in the shorter term at least. So those are some ways that I could think of. I'm going to stress the policy side, because a lot of times technology gets blamed when in fact there's a policy restriction, maybe having to do with mapping requirements, maybe having to do with processes for documentation of rights, that technology can't overcome that always.
True. One last question for each of the panelists I would like to ask you is, definitely a land administration system, whether it is a conventional one or the fit for purpose, is a collective initiative, and the success is entirely dependent upon the proactive approach of each of the stakeholder group. Brent, I would like you to take this question first. What do you think is the prescription for each stakeholder to make a fit for purpose land administration a success?
Adhere to standards,
okay.
Data standards, data model standards, technology standards. Don't write custom code. Mm-hmm. Prepare to be for what's coming next, mm-hmm. so make your system evolvable. Mm-hmm. All successful land administration systems have evolved over time. They're not static. And when you do that, you'll be able to scale not just in size but in function.
Fantastic. Crit, I would like to turn this question to you as well. What, according to you, is the prescription for each stakeholder involved in developing a fit-for-purpose land administration system?
Well, of course, first of all, leadership and commitment. Let's say recognition of all land rights. And then collect the data in a fit-for-purpose approach, as I explained. And then I think the land professionals have to be more flexible, and because it is proven that conventional approaches did not work, so professionals have to change their attitude.
Okay, that's an important point. Professionals have to change their attitude. Jolene, it comes to you next. Okay. What do you think?
Change your
attitude. Well, I actually, I'm glad to hear that we're all on the same page, because my answer would be really that there is no technological prescription. And I do worry sometimes when I read some of the literature that under the name of fit for purpose, we're prescribing that it should always be this technology or that technology. But my colleagues answered in a way that I totally endorse. So I agree with what they said. And flexibility, look from a perspective of sustainability, scalability, find out what will serve the purpose in context.
Fantastic. I think that is more important, what serves the purpose and what serves the context, and no single prescription in terms of technology, but definitely a prescription for the stakeholders in terms of how they participate and what is the attitude they bring to developing a sustainable and scalable fit-for-purpose land administration system. Thank you so much. Thank you, Crit, for joining us on this panel. And sorry for holding you up late in the evening. Thank you, Jolene. Thank you, Brent, for being on this panel.
Thank you.
Are we on? Are we on?